Over the July 4th constituent work week, most members of Congress went back home, talked to their constituents. I can tell you in the 5th District of Texas, the number one question my constituents still have is where are the jobs? I personally held about 8-9 town hall meetings. And I asked the question of many small business people. Is the national debt, do you believe one day you're going to have to pay for it? Everybody's arm went up. Does that make you more likely or less likely to hire more people? To a man and a woman, it makes them less likely. The debt issue, a spending-driven debt, is a job issue. The president has come out to talk about oil and gas and private jets. He's a little late to the party, since in the Republican budget, we have already proposed a fairer, flatter, simpler tax code to create more jobs, which is what the American people care about. If this was about only dealing with the debt, you would ask the president, why is it that his corporate jet loophole is 0.04% of the additional debt that he proposes, and his oil and gas tax provisions are about 0.4% of the spending that he has proposed? Again, the American people are asking, where are the jobs? We've got to cut the spending if we want to increase the jobs.
I heard the same thing over the 4th of July recess from the American people. They keep asking the question, where are the jobs? We know all of the deficit spending and the national debt are a burden on the American people, and they create uncertainty for the American people, and they really create uncertainty for small business people. So if we're serious about beginning to end some of the uncertainty, I think dealing with the short-term debt problems and the long-term debt problems are critically important. President asked us earlier this year to increase the debt limit for our country with no changes in spending and no changes in terms of how we spend the American people's money. I made clear that we would not increase the debt limit without real cuts in spending and real changes to the way we spend the American people's money. I also said that we would not, we would have to cut spending by more than what we would increase the debt ceiling. As these conversations continue, those principles continue to be in place. I've also made clear that we are not going to raise taxes on the American people. We're not going to raise taxes on the very people that we expect to reinvest in our economy and to help grow jobs.
Good morning. I'm looking forward to going to the White House today in what I believe is the beginning of the final stage of discussions over trying to resolve the issue of the debt ceiling. There is no question that when we left the Biden discussions, there was a blueprint on the table where there could be over $2 trillion in savings, consistent with what the Speaker's mandate is, which is we're going to insist, if we're going to vote for the debt ceiling increase, to make sure that the cuts we achieve exceed the amount of the debt ceiling increase. In addition to that, the talks that were ongoing up until 10 days or so ago, they were premised on how we can find common ground. Common ground is getting a hold of the spending situation so we can stop borrowing over 40 cents of every dollar we spend. But I'll make it clear, as I did then, that we as Republicans are not going to support tax increases. It is counterintuitive to think that you can raise taxes in a sputtering economy. So, again, I look forward to going to the White House with the Speaker and seeing how we can come together and resolve this issue so that people across the country can regain some confidence and get back to work.
We're in a town of history, and every day seems to make new. Today marks 799 days since the Senate has passed a budget. If you wonder why that's important, here you are with the largest deficit ever. If you're digging yourself in the hole, the first thing you have to do is stop digging. You got to produce a budget. When you look at small business and you look at the history of America, and you go back to the last recession at the ending in 2001 to 2007, small business, meaning those with 500 employees or less, added 7 million jobs. Those with 500 or more decreased by a million. What does the president propose when we've had the largest unemployment consistently since the Great Depression? job-killing tax increases on small business. That is not a way we're going to get out of this. You want to see real leadership? You look at the House. In 4 months of taking the majority, we passed the budget. What did the budget do? It reined in spending. It had job growth. It had reforming our tax policy that actually made us competitive. It also had an energy policy that put us on the right path. I hope full down at the White House today that we look at the leadership within the House, be able to move and have the Senate fundamentally change where they begin to lead as well.
Last week, the Wall Street Journal referred to this summer as being the jobless summer. And you look at some of the numbers, only 25% of teens are working. You compare that to 10 years ago, 2001, when over 40% were working. 81% of Americans know someone that is seeking to find a job. And the average unemployed American has been searching for a job for 38 weeks now. This is a record. This is nearly 9 months. It's never been that long in the history of America. We can do better. And House Republicans believe that we can do better. We've introduced a plan to get America back to work. We recognize that hardworking middle-class families all across this country expect us to lead, expect us to implement policies that will make their lives easier and get them back to work. And our plan focuses on small businesses and regulatory relief, addressing the debt that faces this country and is really suffocating job growth. That is our plan. We want to move forward on it, and we urge others to join us in that effort.
Back home in Chicagoland, in President Obama's home state, there is a high level of anxiety about job creation and the pathway forward. Small business owners are scratching their head when they look at Washington, D.C., and they are flummoxed at the idea that the remedy that the White House is proposing is to increase taxes on them. And they ask this question, and they've asked me to pose this question to Democratic colleagues and to the White House, and that is, show them a tax increase that has created a job. It's an absurdity. The White House seems like Captain Ahab chasing the big fish. We need the level of commitment that the president is demonstrating on tax increases to be used on deficit reduction and getting this economy back and under control. And the question that has to be asked and has to be answered is, when will this White House recognize that it is their very policies that are creating the obstacle to job creation?